what you see will be. Rhymes that keep their secrets will unfold behind the clouds. And there upon the rainbow is the answer to a never-ending story. She may fade away in your hands, the birth of a new day.
Rhymes that keep their secrets will unfold behind the clouds. And there upon the rainbow is the answer to a never-ending story.
She may fade away in your hands, the birth of a new day.
Rhymes that keep their secrets will unfold behind the clouds. And there upon the rainbow is the answer to a never-ending
I can't believe it's been 30 years and people still remember the film and remember me in the film. It's remarkable.
Wherever in the world I go and meet people, they always say, oh, this film meant everything for me when I was young. This film told me so many wonderful things for my life.
It was not just a commercial success, it was a phenomenon.
Almost everybody I know who saw the movie thought the same thing, that this is going to be one of those movies that becomes a standard, becomes a classic, that generations of children will grow up with this movie.
Michael Ende is the writer of the novel, Neverending Story. It was a huge success in Germany and around the world.
And it was not just a novel that people read because it was suspenseful or full of fantasy. No, it was more than that. It was a novel that gave people an idea of the meaning of life.
It was a true event, and something what we didn't have in Germany for a long, long time, that millions and millions of people, especially kids, were reading.
Dieter Geissler got the rights from Michael Ende, and he brought it to Bernd Eichinger.
Bernd Eichinger was the head of Constantine, which is a German production distribution company, and he was the producer.
When Bernd Eichinger and Dieter Geissler got into the right situation, got the rights, were able to make the book, it was big news in Germany.
Making films based on famous books is always a controversy because the people who had read this book and liked this book, and therefore they want to see it now, I want to see the film because I liked everything in this book. And now they're missing things, they're missing scenes.
You couldn't just take the book and turn this into a screenplay. Would be great, but there were so many things which we just couldn't do. No CGI. Everything had to be practical.
What you were doing during production, you invented the special effects. And that made the movie so expensive at the end of the day.
We were just starting this movie and doing this movie when blue screen was invented. So we could use that technique of blue screen.
We had a screenplay which was already agreed upon by Michael Ende and which had still some moments which were technically not possible to make. The big problem started when Wolfgang wasn't sure how to end this movie.
There's one scene in the movie that is not in the novel. That's the final scene. And I have to give credit for that scene to Bernd. Because we were thinking a lot about, okay, how could we end the movie?
I thought it was the coolest thing in a movie like that, where you are so much into fantasia and you are for a long time just not in our real world anymore. It was just at the very beginning.
And then Bernd said, what do you think of the following? And Wolfgang said, yeah, and then they jump into the trash container.
And I thought it would be the greatest cut if all of a sudden he has never forgotten about how it all started. And we cut from that world right into the, do it the other way around now, right? Not that he is entering Fantasia world, but he is from Fantasia coming back with the Luck Dragon into our world.
Michael Ende's philosophy was everything. What we read and what we will see in the movie is born in the fantasy of the kid. And so this could not be possible to come into the real world with a Fantasian creature.
He was very upset. He didn't like it at all.
He said, you're trying to do a Disney movie. And Bernie said, of course! And I said, but I have my novel is not like that.
So everything was ready. Everything was safe. And Michael Ende tried to stop the movie.
He threatened to stop the release of the movie by an injunction.
Lucky enough, the request for an injunction was not given by the court. And to stop a movie with a budget of 60 million German marks would cause a disaster and it's out of proportion. And Michael Ende lost.
It was high stakes, high profile, big deal, big money. Very expensive.
We knew that the movie would be enormously expensive.
You better be okay with your nerves, because that's easy in a production like this to lose sleep over this.
I think you need this feeling for yourself to be really inspired and to be really creative.
And then Michael Ende and you're breathing down your neck and saying that you should not even do the movie because it's all wrong.
The creatures had already been designed and were already in the process of construction. It was just a matter of getting the script right and the casting right.
We were looking around the world to find a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful girl who could play the Empress. And finally, after months and months, we found her, and that was basically 2 weeks before we started shooting her, way into production already.
We did a bunch of different looks to try to find the Empress. It was really fun. One day they added all these hair extensions, and it was a long process. Every day, another look, another look, another look.
So when you see her then in the film, her face is something almost ethereal. It's something out of this world, like a creature from a different world.
Wolfgang was a really amazing director, and I felt present and able to focus and do the task at hand because he created an environment that made you be present.
And she did it then beautiful. I mean, she was very talented. And then I come also to one of my two or three favorite scenes, when she then finally looks away from Atreyu right into the camera, and that means right to us, and it means right into the eyes of Bastian or so.
Bastian.
Oh my God, I got the goosebumps. It was just amazing from this beautiful face. And then this face was so much despair of, if you don't come, our world goes. And that means for every kid out there.
Wolfgang would set the scene. He would come to me and he would sort of look me in the eyes and he would get down at the same like eye level as me. And he'd say, it's the end of the world. Nothing is going to be left. And I'd be like, nothing? Nothing. It's your job. And I'd be like, oh, no. You know? So he was very convincing.
He's incredible with actors. He wants to get the power of what he's about to show. He wants to get that across.
Atreyu, no! Atreyu!
Barret Oliver, the little guy who plays Bastian. He was a sweetheart. I mean, I just loved him. I mean, he was always sitting on my lap between the takes, and we were like my son. So it was just beautiful.
There was a sense that we both came to it with a little bit more of a like, whoa, where are we?
He was the obvious Bastian because he had these wonderful, big, wandering eyes. And from all the tests we had seen, that was the boy who can dream.
He winds up being as a child what I think is perfection in a young man, to have that gentleness of spirit and courage in the same package.
This is going too far.
He had not so much experience with acting before, but he really grew into this part. He felt like a lead in the story, which was important.
Noah and Atreyu was more difficult to find because he had to have this quality of a warrior kid. So very different than Bastian.
He sort of managed to kind of deliver the performances, but then when he wasn't on camera, he was really just kind of playing, and he was like a true 10-year-old boy.
Noah had a lot of training. Horse riding lessons.
He was a little pale, so we put him in a tanning saloon for 4 weeks.
After all the horse riding lessons, was absolutely believable as the young hero who could overcome all the dangers, all the adventures ahead of him. He was the one who convinced everybody. It was Noah who was our Atreyu.